Dear crypto community and blockchain buddies across the globe, welcome back to Kryptonites, the no BS blockchain channel built with the community and for the community. And today we have two mind-blowing guests, the CEO and CTO of Energy Web Foundation, Walter Cook and Micha Roon. Thank you so much for coming on the show. And before we kick off, a big shout out to Crypto Slate, our partners, one of the best news and data outlets in the crypto ecosystem. So don't forget to check out their website for an awesome summarized version of this interview. And without further ado, thank you so much for coming on the show, Walter and Micha. How are you guys doing today?
I'm doing great.
Thanks, Alex, for having us.
It's lovely, lovely to have you guys. The Energy Web has been a big topic in 2020. Congratulations for all the great success, the partnerships and everything. So today, guys, we're going to cover some really interesting topics such as 2020, the best of the highlights, energy on the chain, other assets than financial services on the chain, the predictions for 2021 and more. So don't forget to stay tuned to the very end. So the first question here is for you, Walter. Imagine you, Micha, myself, driving a car in the sunset across the mountains, and all of a sudden we look in the rear window. What do you see? What were the biggest highlights for the blockchain and crypto space in 2020?
Sure, definitely. Well, as you can imagine, I'm driving an electrical vehicle, but I'm still looking back in the mirrors. And that's been a wild year for Energy Web and the whole community. I think what's unique about us is that we're not a company with shareholders. We're actually a membership organization. We have 100 plus members. And 2020 has really been the year for us where we started to make things happen. So, of course, we had a lot of listings. We've been listing now on 4 exchanges. We have seen real first deployments of our Energy Web operating system, and members are really starting to apply now this open source technology into their day-to-day processes, whether it's energy certificates, whether it's flexibility markets. So I think that is really exciting, a very transformative year for Energy Web and all its members.
Fantastic. And now changing the song for you, Micha, when you look back at 2020, what were the most exciting developments that you feel that values the blockchain in 2020?
Well, for me, 2020 was the year of starting to make our vision a reality. So we ended 2019 with this big vision of the Energy Web decentralized operating system. We'll come back to that later. And 2020 has been the year where we started building the first components of it, and it was very well accepted, and it encouraged us to build it. And obviously also all the gains that the Energy Web token has made had a big impact on my mood of 2020. And the big finale with Bitcoin crossing 20K in December, that was a big event.
That was definitely a big event. And actually the markets are rallying right now. I'd love to hear, this is an unexpected question, but how do you guys feel? Are we in the euphoria, or is this still a healthy bull run?
I think it's on Bitcoin, definitely it's still a healthy bull run. I think the big difference is I've been in Bitcoin since, 2016-ish. And then of course it was quite speculative and only for a very small group. But I think what really happened last year is two big things. So one is you see the real enterprises, the big money coming in, leveraging their assets, not just in fiat, but also in Bitcoin for its, it's being seen as sound money, I guess. And the other thing is that there's been so much models going out over the last 2 years, actually, whether it's stock to flow or any other model in Bitcoin, that actually, so there are real expectations also on where the price can go. And yeah, if you believe them, or if you only take 50% of them, then I still think we've only just started. It's different this time. It's much more enterprise driven, much more enterprise adoption, for me at least. Yeah. Not sure about you, Micha. Any views on Bitcoin?
It's really hard to assess, but you are right. Enterprises are getting in, and so the volatility will go down a little, which will be very welcome. And the rise will be maybe slower in the coming year, but more steady with less, jigsaws. So that's nice. And it brings visibility to crypto, which is very welcome as well. We have seen pretty much U-turns from the banking sector on crypto. Mm-hmm. So it's really promising. I am very confident in the future.
I think that's a very good point too, Alex, that now you actually see the financial regulators stepping up. There's Stablecoin X, there's bank license going to Kraken, there's exchanges being built by regulated banks. So it's good. It starts to mingle. So yeah, it will be big.
Very well put, gentlemen. And a lot of people agree with you guys that this bull run is very different from the one in 2017. We can expect less volatility. Obviously, last time it wasn't fun in 2018, the crypto winter. Are we going to have a crypto winter, by the way, again, guys? Or do you think it's over now that the institutional money is in the game and now that the space is taking more seriously?
Yeah, personally, I don't think we'll get into a winter. Yeah, sure, we'll get a dip. There will be volatility. There will be some profits taking, I don't know, at 40, 50K levels. But it won't be, no, because it's the money keeps, there's so much money floating in. There's not many people selling. So yeah, the trend is only upwards, I think. Yeah.
Fantastic. Micha?
Yeah, I completely agree with that assessment. I mean, it's a market, so there will be volatility, but a lot less. And the value is there. I mean, there are so many people on this planet making money that do not trust their governments. They need an escape route, and crypto is a very good one.
All right, great. Well, thank you so much, gentlemen, for that. And I'd love to transition to EnergyWeb. You know, when I look at the Twitter feed, actually, one of the most exciting things that I see on the page is EnergyWeb. Our mission is to accelerate the low carbon energy transition through open source digital tech, which is more important and hopeful than ever. If you don't mind telling us, Walter, why is it so important to disrupt the energy space and use blockchain technology to do so?
Yeah, it's actually one of the better applications, I would say, of blockchain in a sector. So I've mainly worked in telecoms, also a couple of years, 5 years in a bank. And of course, when you look at blockchain and banking, it's disruptive for a different way, because a bank runs its P&L on the central ledger, and of course, blockchain challenges that and takes out the middleman. What's happening in the energy sector is actually quite different. A lot of consumers like you and I and people watching this webinar are actually buying energy assets, whether it's an electrical vehicle, smart thermostat, heat pumps, whatever. So it's us consumers investing in energy assets that consume energy, but that also produce energy. And that whole decentralization of ownership of energy assets needs to be facilitated by the grids. Because if you're a grid operator, if you're building an energy infrastructure, and you are not going to include the EVs or the power plants or the heat pumps into how you manage the grid, then you just lose out on the big opportunity. So the whole trend of ownership, local ownership of energy assets by consumers like you and I is excellently facilitated by blockchain, because what we can do now also with our infrastructure is that all these assets can get an identity. They can be vetted by the authorities that actually, because it's still a regulated market, but if I claim I have a Tesla, my utility can say, yeah, that's a Tesla with this capacity, etc. And when you have that verified claim, then your asset can participate in markets. And so there's no need to onboard in a centralized database. There's no need to actually do all kind of inefficient processes. Any assets can be trusted, and if you want to, as a consumer, can participate in this market. So it's a really, really, really good use case. And the beauty of all of it is because we're all investing in green assets, you need to build less coal or black energy assets. So that just contributes to bringing the carbon footprint down. Yeah, and the way we roll it out is actually with the sector. So we're not fighting against them. Our members are the utilities. They are the big energy companies. They want this to happen because they want to go to a green world too. And that's why it's so powerful now. So it's the big players from the sector. It's the technologists, and it's also the regulators that are all driving in the same direction.
Fantastically put. And Micha, I'm sure, of course, you agree with all that. And is this how you see it as well? Like a big problem that is solved? Because as Walter was saying, you know, a lot of people picture financial services as the main application on the blockchain, but energy has its space. Definitely. Could you tell us a little bit more about that?
I believe that blockchain is not about money. It's about trust. Money obviously needs trust, but there are other things that need trust too. And one of these other things is identity. as Valdo said, if you own a Tesla and people can recognize your Tesla on the digital marketplace, then you can participate as a Tesla owner. But this claim that you own a Tesla and that your car is actually what it claims to be, this goes through the implementation of a digital identity infrastructure. And making this digital identity infrastructure self-sovereign, so giving the individual user agency over their identity, is what we are building today. And this is the enabler of the marketplace. It is also very important to note that the energy market, as Valdo mentioned, is composed of many different players. And the number of players is only increasing with the decentralization of asset ownership. And there is simply no way of managing all these connections in a peer-to-peer fashion. You don't have the capability anymore to create peer-to-peer connections as we did in the past. So having the TSO connecting to a DSO, that's okay because the number of DSOs and TSOs is small. But when you add prosumers to the mix, there are simply so many people involved that you need a decentralized system that enables you to manage all these connections in a trustworthy way. And trust is the key word here. We are building trust between the players in the energy market.
Fantastic. Thank you so much for that. And you just mentioned enterprises and consumers. So that's really interesting. Walter, when it comes to the actual enterprises and adoption of the tech and the network, how is the Energy Web DOS supporting them? And how are these enterprises making use of the technology that you guys are building to make the world a better place?
Yeah, very good question, Alex. Yeah, so I think it's best to use the analogy of good old-fashioned telecom networks, because that, first of all, I've worked 25 years there, but it's very, very much how what's actually happening. So in the good old days, I think we all remember it, you had these dial phones where you had click, 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 and they're very analog. And then if I would make a phone call to Misha, there would be a real physical connection to each other. So a very dumb endpoint of the network, this stupid phone that... is a dial phone and a very hierarchical setup network that actually routes the call and makes the connection. And now we have the network where everything is mobile, and your mobile smartphone is actually a computer. It can, you don't know as a network operator where it is, and you don't know what it's going to do. So your network needs to be able to facilitate these very smart devices, both from a connectivity, a latency, a bandwidth perspective. So the whole telecoms network have completely transformed from analog, centrally driven to digital and all kind of services facilitating these smartphones. That's exactly what's happening in energy. It was a couple of big power plants and just generating power, pushing it to the houses, and you and I switch on the light. And now in a new world, you have electrical vehicles with batteries, you have smart devices, and actually you can start controlling these devices. Where you can, your car can give back power to the net, your fridge can switch on and off whenever the net needs it, et cetera, et cetera. So a huge transformation for all these grid operators. We call them the TSOs, the big lines, and the DSOs, the one that actually come into your house. And what they've said, rather than us all inventing it on our own per country, let's do this together. Let's build this digital infrastructure once, make it open source so we can all use it and everybody can innovate on it. And that's what we're doing. And because we've also built it on the blockchain layer, which is our layer of trust, as Misha explained, we also have the benefit of having a native token. And that native token can then also take care of all the financial settlements that need to happen. Consumers will probably just settle in Swiss francs or in euros or in dollars, but internally it's very efficient when it comes to settlement and all that stuff using our native token. So that's really what we're doing. We're building the digital infrastructure with the sector in an open source model. And we invite a lot of new companies to innovate on top of it, like you've seen lots of innovation on the internet. And then because it's all public infrastructure, everybody benefits, it's open source.
Very nicely put. And that's a perfect transition, Walter. For me, I would love to ask you about the Energy Web Token. And of course, Walter, you can comment. So if someone is kind of a new, like a rookie in this space and wants to get involved, loves your mission, loves your message, Like, can you tell us a little bit more about the Energy Web token in layman's terms for people to understand it? That'd be great.
I'm not sure how lay the man can be, but the Energy Web token is a native token of our chain. The Energy Web chain is an EVM chain, so an energy Ethereum virtual machine. It is different from the Ethereum chain in that it is validated by authorities. So we have a proof of authority chain, but the functionality of the chain remains the same. So whatever you can do on Ethereum, you can do on the Energy Web chain. And our token, from a technical point of view, is not very different. From a usage point of view, it is actually quite different because the gas price is pretty low. There is no competition for the validators of the Energy Web chain. Everyone gets a turn, and there is no randomness or competition here. And so the fees are kept very low. We actually operate on a 0.1 gigaway gas price, which is very nice when you compare it to the 100 gigaway gas price of Ethereum. So our token has another utility as well. It will be used to pay for the infrastructure. The digital infrastructure is not composed only by the Energy Web chain. It is composed actually by a utility layer that is anchored on this chain. So the chain provides the trust, and we have components that provide utility, like messaging. The different agents need to be able to communicate with one another, so they need a decentralized messaging mechanism. Blockchain is not very well suited for that. You need to be able to recover a lost private key. We do not want to live in a world where when you lose your phone, you lose $100,000 because you had your Energy Web tokens locked on your phone. So we want to provide this capability of recovering private keys in a decentralized and trustworthy manner. So I will not go into the details of that, but we have come up with a mechanism to reward not only the validators of the chain, but also the utility service providers of the chain. And the Energy Web token will be used to reward the entire ecosystem and not just the Energy Web chain validators.
Fantastic. And Walter, any comments on that, on the Energy Web token? That'd be great.
Yeah, so what's important to realize that we're actually quite a unique organization or community, because we have an open public, open source blockchain in an enterprise setting. And typically you see enterprise settings with private blockchains. And so what Misha already said, our validators, the one actually that provide the trust, we have around 35 to 40. The majority of them are big corporates, also some startups. It's like companies like Shell or NG, huge corporates. So they don't do this to make money. They do this to contribute to the mission of the foundation. So that element of proof of work blockchains like Bitcoin, where you really stimulate the trust through giving these rewards in return for some work, that's not what we have. So that means that our token gets a totally different utility. Yes, it's used for paying for gas, but it's actually also a mechanism to provide real utility at the service layer. So what we envision is that in the future, if you want to run a couple of service nodes, for example, like messaging nodes, or you want to provide storage, and it can be you, Alex, or anybody who wants to do it, you could spin up that service on top of our in our Energy Web DOS, and then through staking, give the trust if nobody knows you. Of course, if you are if you're Shell or NV Energy, people know you, they might trust you a little bit more. And so the, from a staking perspective, there's real utility. And then, of course, also from what was mentioned before, just as a payment mechanism in this digital infrastructure, when you go and settle amongst each other, there's really no need to do that in euros or dollars or whatever. You can just do that in the native token. It's much more integrated into the whole tech stack. And perhaps lastly, what we're also going to experiment with this year is because these enterprises, they require service levels, of course. They want availability of service, guarantees on the quality of service, latency, etc. We're also now going to experiment with mechanisms where these service levels can be organized by a completely decentralized community and then using staking mechanisms. Like you see in Polkadot architectures where you have staking for, yes, you can trust me. And we actually want to go and work with staking mechanisms where you can say, yes, I'll make sure this service is up and running. Yeah. So that much more to come there. Yeah.
Very cool, Walter. And I'd love to follow up. You just mentioned the word future. And obviously, what is the brightest future for you, Walter? What would make you feel like you want to go see Micha and give him a big hug? You feel like, okay, Energy Web Foundation has achieved the ultimate goal. What does that look like for you guys?
Yeah. So for me, well, if it would be possible to go and visit Misha, that would be already something cool for me. But we can leave COVID behind us because we've been operating like everybody else in the very virtual world, of course, over 2020. So I look forward to that moment anyway. But the big bomb will be for us is all around real deployment of our open source infrastructure in business critical processes, grid utilities, operating their digital layer on the Energy Web chain at mass. So 4 million EVs in Switzerland, identities, 30 million in California, et cetera, et cetera. So we will do these big steps. We're not going to be incremental. If we get a real deployment, then it's bang, couple of million on top of it. And that's really what success for me looks like. It's no longer proving that it works. We've done that in 2020. It works, our members believe it, the regulators love it. It's now really the next step, making it happen in real operational environments.
Very nicely put, Walter. Micha, any comments on that, on the ultimate success of the future?
For me too, the ultimate success is usage, so that our technology gets adopted. We want to deploy, well, at least 3 services this year. We have started with the alpha release of Switchboard, which is our decentralized identity and access management system. This is available actually to manage any identity and access for any application. So it's not reserved to energy. We have built it for the energy and enterprise system. What sets our infrastructure apart is mainly that we focus on the enterprise world. Our decentralized technology must be usable by an enterprise, which is very different from all the other decentralized projects out there. They are very nice projects and very innovative projects, but they are focused on the open source and decentralized and small enterprise world or small company world. And we don't have this liberty. So for me, what really looks like success in 2021 is that we have a few million users and the backing of a major energy enterprise like a transmission system operator or a distribution system operator in a big place like Amsterdam. We have connections with the Rotterdam DSO, who is interested to deploy something. But it's just interest right now. We need to execute.
Fantastic. And you just mentioned your kind of your feelings, predictions for 2021 and what's going to happen this year. If we can go on a more general topic, I'd love to ask you, Walter, like 2021, like what are the superpowers and potentially what are the supervillains? You know, some people fear some things in 2021 as well. But generally speaking, in the blockchain and crypto space, like what are your predictions on what's going to happen? What are the best case scenarios and what would you fear as well in 2021?
Yeah, so I think what I can definitely see happening is real adoption of blockchain technology in what I call the real world. We have the CryptoKitties world and we have the real world, and we operate in the real world. And what that means, the real world operates in a legal context. They operate with regulations, whether we like it or not. You know, we have laws in countries, and these laws are also going to apply for crypto. And I think that's what you see happening now also in a lot of these initiatives. So some people don't like it, and they see actually crypto as the way to stay out of the legal context. to be able to do payments without KYC, et cetera, but that will never create impact. Of course, it was fun in 2015 that you could send a Bitcoin to somebody and nobody noticed. But if you want this to be really mass adopted and get into the real life of the people, then, you know, we operate in a legal context. So I see regulators really stepping up. It's already happening. They're focused on stablecoins. I do hope, that's why I'm a little bit nervous that this whole stablecoin discussion, of course, it was fired up by Libra. I think they, there was quite a defensive reaction from a lot of the regulators. I've been in a couple of these sessions too. And I think that's where also regulators need to be a little bit bolder and not just defend what's there, but also take a broader look. But that's how that's going to play out, because then you go into geopolitics, of course, China, US, Europe. Anyway, I'm not educated in that area, but that's that could deliver some really bad results if they make it political and not factual. But in general terms, I think 2021 will be really the year where enterprises start to adopt. We've seen it in Bitcoin adoption now since the middle of last year. That will continue. I see it myself in the energy sector, where people really deploy this technology. And what I mean with deployment, I mean open public infrastructure. Similar to what we saw when the internet came, first people, enterprises started to experiment with intranets before they moved to the internet. Cloud, first they started to experiment with private cloud before they moved to public cloud. They've now also experimented with private blockchains, which is of course nonsense. Why would you have a blockchain between parties that trust each other already? So if you then start to move to public infrastructures, really opening up your company to consumers and have them really participate digitally in your business, I think that's what we will see happen more and more. So no, I'm very, very bullish on the whole sector. In 2016, I said to myself, I don't want to miss out on this one. So that's, I was very fortunate I could move into it in 2018. And it's great. It's a roller coaster every day, but it's actually happening. I can see it. So we're on a good path.
I agree 100% with you, Walter. I feel like we're very fortunate to be living in these times and to enjoying it and participating in what's happening in this space. And Michal, if I can ask you the same question, you know, 2021, what are the superheroes? What are the supervillains? It sounds like stable coins, regulatory CBDCs, and all these things happen to be on Walter's mind. What are some other things that you see happening this year?
What I see happening this year is decentralized systems that are based on blockchain, but are not necessarily blockchain. I'm referring to projects like dGraph protocol or Link, which are also trust light, but decentralized. So I see the advent of this kind of applications and infrastructure. Our messaging infrastructure is one of this. Our key recovery infrastructure will be one of this. This will boost the value and utility of blockchain as a whole, and hence it will be beneficial for everyone. And the big nemesis of this whole decentralization movement is botched regulation. We have the technology to stay anonymous and to benefit from the benefits of doubt. So unless proven guilty, you should not be followed. And unless you are a money launderer, you should be able to transact anonymously. And we have the technology to actually prove these things. So I can prove to you that I have been KYC'd without telling my name, without telling who has KYC'd me. But the regulator does not know about these technologies. And my fear is that no one will tell the regulator that these technologies exist, and they will set up centralized registries that will be hacked. Obviously, every central registry will be hacked, and that my details will leak out, and that everyone will be able to find out that I'm the owner of 100 BTC and come knocking on my door. I really fear that scenario.
I guess that's a really good point. And as you guys mentioned, the regulations or regulators in the US already hurt XRP quite badly. Yeah. And then obviously there's a stablecoin CBDCs that have been a threat to certain stablecoins in some regions. So regulatory kind of fear is definitely one. And as you mentioned, Micha, the data oracles and data companies is definitely a great use case other than financial services. We have EnergyWeb as well. And for you, Walter, like, are there any other particular asset classes or sub-asset classes that you're really interested in that are not necessarily directly connected to financial services in terms of the blockchain use and adoption this year?
Definitely, yeah. So I think that when it comes to, I'm going back to the mission, of course, of EnergyWeb. So we're here to build a digital infrastructure to decarbonize the grid. And what you see, so we're doing that now for electricity markets, also for certificates. So you can actually prove that energy that has been produced is green by wind turbines or by solar. But you now also see that in adjacent sectors like green hydrogen, or so there's a, or even the, we're talking a lot with the battery, Global Battery Alliance, that if you produce a battery, how do you actually know that the material used in a battery comes from renewable sources, what, there was no child labor involved, et cetera, et cetera. So I think more and more, fast forward 5 years, if a consumer buys a product, all the proof will be somewhere on that whole supply chain, on the blockchain, and it's much more transparent what you're actually consuming, who's been making money out of it, how honest is this product. So the choices we're going to make, I think, will be from a much broader context, not just the best product for the lowest price, but also the fair product and then provable fair. So I think business models will really change. I think big propositions will come there. And I personally, what I also see, and that's new for me since I work at EnergyWeb since 18, the power of open source and open source communities is not to be underestimated. It's actually how people like to work together. People don't like to come to an office, listen to a boss that tells them what to do it, and they actually think it's different. And what I see also in how we develop our own ecosystem and software is we have the best talents from around the world contributing. And they either do it for money, yeah, because they also need an income, or they do it because they're passionate about it. And I think that's what you're going to see more and more. And again, that's powered by the blockchain, because if I can prove that what I'm saying, you can trust that that's true, yeah, then why would you not trust it? So I think, yeah, it's like I've said, I think this is, we're really at the beginning of the transformation. I think this is really, if we execute this right and we get the regulators behind us, because in the end, the regulators are there to protect the consumers, yeah? We should not forget that. So they're not there to protect the big money, but they're there to protect the consumers. So if they also make that move, then I think we can really evolve how we operate a society in a broader sense. But it will manifest itself in banking for sure, in energy and adjacent industries. And I think, yeah, that's then upwards in the supply chain of producing goods. Those are, I think, the three hotspots.
Fantastic and very profoundly put, not just the technological changes, the socioeconomic, the social changes and everything that the open source infrastructure has to offer to society. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for your time today. It was lovely getting to chat with both of you, both the CEO and CTO of EnergyWeb Foundation. You guys are both active on Twitter. I mean, I've seen your account, Walter, on Twitter. So if you want to follow you, it's just at Walter Kook, K-O-O-K. And the EnergyWeb feed is at EnergyWebX. Is that correct?
That's correct. Yep, spot on.
Fantastic. We'll have a lovely, lovely month of July. Hopefully you guys will be able to reunite, you know, once the restrictions are removed and actually give yourself a hug in person.
Okay. Thank you very much. Bye-bye, Alex. Cheers.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you guys for watching today. Don't forget to like, subscribe, and blast that bell notification so you can get access to more of these awesome interviews with people who are moving the space in the right direction. We love you for watching and supporting us every Wednesday, premiering at a PC near you, 8 o'clock GMT. Thank you so much, and see you next week, guys.